medical studies, I started volunteering in the psychiatric clinic. I went to study medicine because of reading Freud, and so I, you know, started working in psychiatry before I actually graduated. And to my preceptor, who got this sample from Sandoz, was very interested in LSD, but didn't have enough time. So he used us to sit with people. So I was sitting with people actually since 1954, but initially they didn't allow students to have. I had to wait for my graduation, and one of the first things I did in 56 was actually to volunteer for an LSD session.
And how was that experience?
Well, it was something that changed my life professionally, personally. My preceptor, who was what we call a docent in Prague, with a degree under the professor, docent Robicek, he was very interested in electroencephalography. And at the time when the experiments were happening, he was particularly interested in a particular method which was called driving the brain waves, or entraining the brain waves, which was exposing people to a powerful stroboscopic light with different frequencies, and studying the electroencephalogram, whether the brain waves in the corresponding part of the brain, which would be the suboccipital for the optical stimulation, would pick up the frequency that you are feeding in, if you can drive them, train them, and so on. So one of the conditions for me to get LSD, I would agree to have the EEG before, during, and after, and also part of it was the experiment of being exposed to very powerful stroboscopic light. So I had a session, you know, which was fascinating at the beginning. Was incredible display of colors, kaleidoscopic displays. It was like the world of Islam, the arabesques, I felt like, was in Granada at one point, and so on. And then it opened up, and I explored some of my past, from childhood, and so on. And so it was interesting in itself, but then came the experiment with the stroboscope that just took it to a completely different level. It was between the third and the fourth hour when the research assistant came, and it was time, you know, to do the experiment. So she took me to the small cell. There was a couch. I lay down. She pasted the electrodes on my head, and then brought this giant strobe and you know, asked me to close my eyes, and she sort of turned it on. And even with my eyes closed, I saw light of intensity, of brightness that I had never seen in my life, and I even couldn't imagine existed. It was like, you know, when you read mystical literature and they talk about was light, it was like millions of suns, or I thought that it was like it would, what it must have been like in Hiroshima. I mean, it was that intensity. And my consciousness was catapulted out of my body, and I lost connection with the research assistant, with the clinic, with Prague, with the planet. And I had this amazing experience of my consciousness just embracing everything, becoming everything there was. And then on, as I was coming down, I actually was in the physical universe, or actually became the physical universe somehow. I had the feeling I had been back to Big Bang, and there were experiences that I didn't have names for, but later when I read about the black holes, white holes, I mean, it was something in that category, pulsars, you know. Amazing cosmic experience. So I came down very, very impressed, and it just generated this lifetime interest in these non-ordinary states. So in the last over 50 years, I have really done very little professionally that wouldn't involve these non-ordinary states. This became my vocation, my profession, my passion.
So what kind of potential did you initially see in psychedelics professionally?
Well, I was trained as a, you know, as a clinical psychiatrist, so my initial interest was actually in something that was mentioned in a letter from Sandoz, that this substance in incredibly minuscule dosages, like millions of a gram, could change profoundly the psychological functioning for several hours. And so they were suggesting that this could be, we could use it as a kind of a model of naturally occurring psychosis, that we could do various tests, psychological, biochemical, electrophysiological, before, during, and after the experience, and as a result of it, understand what's happening biochemically, biologically, electrophysiologically, and so on, in the organism at the time when people's mental functioning was so profoundly influenced. And of course the excitement about it was that these dosages were so small that it was conceivable that the human body could, under certain circumstances, by some aberration of metabolism, produce a substance like that. And that actually what we consider mental diseases, particularly schizophrenia, would be really chemical aberrations. And if we could identify the category of substances or the substance that was causing it, it would be possible to develop some antidote, some substance that would neutralize it, and we would have a kind of a test tube solution for schizophrenia. It's like, would be like a holy grail in psychiatry, you know, the one of the most serious challenges that psychiatrists have. So my initial experiments were really in that category. I joined a group of people who had access to several psychedelic substances. Besides LSD, it was also psilocybin, psilocin later, and then we had a connection with a group of from Budapest, from Hungary, Steven Zara, and they developed a whole sequence of tryptamine derivatives, dimethyl, diethyl, dipropyl, tryptamine. They were also very powerful psychedelic substances, and they were particularly exciting because tryptamine is part of the metabolism of tryptophan, which is an amino acid that exists in the organism. So it was particularly important candidate for the substance that could cause naturally occurring psychotic states. So we had a group of people, about 40 people, that included ourselves, who would come to a research institute always for a day, and on a double-blind basis they would get one of these psychedelics or placebo, and then go through a series of tests. You know, we'd be collecting samples of blood every hour on the hour, urine every hour on the hour, psychological tests, electrophysiological tests, and so it's very, very kind of traditional scientific approach. And then we would bring a psychotic patient, matched with these other people by age, by sex, by gender, and so by IQ, and put them through the same tests. And we were trying to find out to what extent the test results in the people who took LSD would start converging with what you're finding in schizophrenic patients. And In the process of this work, I became really interested in one particular phenomenon, which was the unbelievable inter-individual and also intra-individual variability of the experiences. If these 40 people, you know, each of them took the same dose under the same circumstances, and everybody's session was absolutely different.